Here we are, Romans chapter 5. I thought today would be just a really quick lesson. Friends, I have just been digging. There are so many riches, so many treasures in today's passage. I hope that you have found some of them. Let's go ahead and begin by reading the passage, and we'll try to tease this out. I'm wondering, okay, what do I share? There's so much here. All right, let's just read. Here we are, Romans chapter 5, verse 1. Therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Through him, we have also obtained access by faith into this grace in which we stand, and we rejoice in hope of the glory of God. Not only that, but we rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. Beautiful. Okay, well, we have this first word, therefore, and it's always good to notice those transition words. Therefore, what is what I ask? And Paul really gives us a good clue here. He goes on to say, since we have been justified by faith. So we could say, therefore, what? Or we could say, since we have been justified by faith, what? All right. The cross reference here is Romans 3:28, justified. For we hold that one is justified by faith apart from works of the law. So here we are. Paul has made his case, really, in chapters 3 and chapters 4. That cross reference takes us back to chapter 3, that we are justified by faith. And he affirms that. Okay, we've made this point here. We're all agreeing, right, Romans? We all are agreeing that we are justified by faith alone and not by works. This has nothing to do with circumcision or the law or anything else. It is by faith alone. So Paul has made that abundantly clear. And here's a transition word. Therefore, since we have been justified, and remember that is to be or to become judicially vindicated as having complied with the requirements of the law of God. All right, so legally, we have this rightness, we have this goodness with God, we have a restored relationship with him, we are friends with him by faith in Jesus. Okay, next I ask, what is the result? What is the result of justification by faith? Verse 1, Paul says, look, peace with God through Jesus. Peace, friends. That's harmonious relations and freedom from disputes. We have this friendship with God, this shalom with God, this wholeness with him. We are right. We are good with God. Beautiful, right? Okay, so we have that peace with God through Jesus. We also, Paul says in verse 2, have obtained access by faith into this grace in which we stand. All right, access to God's grace again through Jesus. And we've talked about grace being God's gift. Here's his mercy, his forgiveness, like being justified by way of faith. That's not our work. That justification work is God's grace. It's his gift to us through Jesus. All right, so we have peace with God through Jesus. We have access to his grace through Jesus. And we also have this hope of the glory of God. And I ask, what is this? All right, what is this? Here's where I've landed, friends. One, maybe I should just define a couple of words. Hope is that general feeling that some desire will be fulfilled. And we've talked about that in the last chapter last week. We saw that Abraham had hope, right? That God would do as he had promised to do. Abraham is our example of believing in God, that he is going to do what he says he will do. All right, so hope is this, I feel like it should be more than a feeling. It's a knowing that God is going to do what he will do. So this hope of the glory of God. Glory is this high state of honor. It's not an easy word to summarize. And I think that some of the cross references might help us. And I'll tell you the word that opened up just this whole window. It like took off the ceiling to better understand this glory of God was the word access in this verse. Access is an opportunity of admittance. It's an opportunity to have access to the presence of a superior, especially for speaking with a superior. All right, so friends, what would it mean if somebody said to us, okay, I'm giving you all a ticket to meet with God today, to meet with God face to face in his glory? I'm going to open up the door for you to be able to do that. Oh, friends, that's what Paul is saying we have. And here's there were many cross-references, but here are two that I starred. I want to read them all. I'll go ahead. Ephesians 2:18, for through him, meaning through Jesus, we have access in one spirit to the Father. All right, that's pretty clear. We have access to God through Jesus. He's opened up this door for us. Ephesians 3:12, in whom we have boldness and access with confidence through our faith in Jesus. All right, and then here's the one I have hearts by these, Hebrews. This is Hebrews 10 and 19. Therefore, brothers and sisters, since we have confidence to enter the holy places by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain, through his flesh. All right, that paints a visual picture. And for those of us who have studied the tabernacle or studied the temple, last year we were in Exodus and we really studied the tabernacle and we understand what that curtain is. We understand what the Holy of Holy is, and that people just generally did not have access to that. Only once a year the priest went in to make a sacrifice there in the Holy of Holies. Oh, friends, no one had access to that, but by Jesus, here's what the author of Hebrews says, since we have confidence to enter the holy places by the blood of Jesus, by this new and living way that he opened for us. All right, that new and living way. We've talked about that way, meaning road. Here is the new road. It's a living road for us. Here is the new way to have access to God. And it is for everyone. Friend, it is for you. It is for me. It's open to anyone who will believe and have faith. I don't know. I have goosebumps over that, friends. This is absolutely stunning. And I just say, wow. Look at how we have been blessed. Look at the gifts we have received from God. And we'll talk about that in just a minute. What do we learn about who God is from this passage? What does Paul know about God that he shares with us, and the gifts that God gives? Oh, friends, is that not stunning? Is that not beautiful? I hope that you see it too. All right, so Paul says, he goes on to say that we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. And not only that, but we rejoice in our sufferings. So here's something key in verse 3. All right, we can all say yes, hallelujah. We rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Oh, and I forgot to say this in explaining it, that this is on the last day. Paul is believing that on the last day, believers will be glorified. They will enjoy this high state of honor with God. There will be no more suffering, friends. There will be no more brokenness. We will be restored with God in this high state of honor with God. We will be with Him face to face, and we will be made right with Him, reflecting Him as those restored mirrors, reflecting His image as we were created to do. All right, that's the hope we have to look forward to. We can rejoice in that, but to rejoice in our sufferings, we might put a question mark. We ought to put a question mark by that. Really, Paul? What do you mean by rejoicing in our sufferings? I put this, what? Once I believe and I am justified by faith, life still involves suffering, meaning it still involves distress, whether that distress is physical, mental, social, or economic, any kind of trouble. You mean, Paul, even though I have this hope of the glory of God, I'm still going to have suffering? And basically, Paul says, yes, yes. Yes, Paul is realistic about suffering. As one scholar put it, Paul knows nothing of the health and wealth gospel. All right, he does not preach that at all. No, Paul is very realistic that in this world, just as Jesus told us, in this world, we will have trouble. All right, but Paul says, look, we can rejoice in these adversities. We can rejoice in the trouble. We can rejoice in the suffering, right? This is a key point in this passage. Why? Why can we rejoice? What does it mean to rejoice? Friends, that's the same word as boast, to show off verbally. Oh, we can boast in our sufferings? Why? Paul goes on to say that suffering produces endurance. All right, endurance. We see a couple of cross references there. Luke 21:19. This is Jesus. By your endurance, you will gain your life. And of course, many of us know James 1:3. We've studied James, for you know the testing of your faith produces steadfastness. All right. Suffering produces endurance. Endurance produces character. That means dependability, reliability, and then this character produces hope. All right, this knowing, this understanding, this feeling that God is going to do what He said He would do, being fully convinced, as Abraham was, that God will do as He promises to do, that we will be with Him in glory. All right, produce. To produce means to cultivate, to prepare someone for some use. Okay, here's the fruit. Right? Suffering produces endurance. Endurance produces character. Character produces hope. It produces this beautiful, glimmering, shining faith that we live out here in the midst of a world of suffering, that others might know Jesus. All right, it has a purpose to it. And although we can't explain suffering, and we should never just have pat answers for suffering, because suffering is hard. It is suffering. It is distressful. We can know that it does produce fruit, and God allows it to produce fruit in us. He allows it to grow our faith. He allows for it to help us be fully convinced that He's going to do, that He's going to fulfill His promises. Friends, I want to just quickly go through what I learned about God, but let me first just give you how I summarize this, the main point that I see today. It's important to hold on to main points in Paul's letters. Since we have been justified by faith, let us rejoice in the hope of the glory of God and in our suffering. All right, did you get that? Since we have been justified by faith, is what Paul is saying, let us rejoice in the hope of the glory of God and in our suffering. All right, that's a main point for Paul today. What does he know about who God is? Well, friends, he tells us that God has gifted us with peace through Jesus. He's gifted believers with peace through Jesus. He's gifted believers with access to his grace and to his glory. God is gracious. God is glorious. He has this high state of honor, and we now have access through Jesus into that. What a blessing. What a gift. And then God, what else do I learn about God? He's gifted us with this hope of glory. That's his gift. What else? Although suffering can't be explained, God allows for it to grow our confidence in him. All right. We also see in verse 5 that God loves us. And we see that he pours out his love into our hearts through our spirit. Friends, this is beautiful. This is stunning as well. God doesn't say, look, I'll see you on the other side. Good luck getting through all of this suffering. No, through Jesus, he's poured out his love into our hearts through his Holy Spirit, that we might have this hope, that we might have his help to hold on to this hope, to endure, to grow in character, to grow in hope, and to stand firm in faith. What a good, good God. What an amazing God. Oh, let us rejoice in him. Let us rejoice in the glory that he has shared with us, and this glory that we have to look forward to on that last day. And friends, let's ask for his help to rejoice in the midst of the suffering that we face today.